Hello, Saints. I wanted to make this video and I just wanted to share my beliefs and my opinion on why I believe that God only tells us in bits and pieces, you know, like through dreams, some of us having a dream about this and certain of us having a dreams about that, but we're just knowing in parts, bits and pieces. God never really tells us the whole of anything. And, you know, you wonder, well, why does God do that? Why don't he just tell us everything at one time? And, you know, we can begin to prepare. Why do he tell us in bits and pieces? And so this is just my personal opinion of why I believe that God tells us in very bits and pieces. So let's turn the pages of the Bible and let's try to figure this thing out in Jesus' name. Amen. So, the Bible tells us in 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 12, "For now we see through a glass darkly, but then face to face. Now I know in part, but then shall I know even as also I am known." So he says, "For we know in part, and we prophesy in part." So we only know a little bit, and the little bit that we know, we're prophesying in that little bit because we don't even have the whole of it. This is what they were saying way back when. I don't know if this is Peter or Paul speaking, but he was saying, "For we know in part and we prophesy in part, but when that which is perfect is come, which is Jesus, then that which is in part shall be done away with." When Jesus comes back, we're going to know the whole full of it. But right now, we only know bit by bit by bit by bit. So right now, it's like we're looking through a glass darkly. And when you look through a glass, it distorts the image. So we're unable to see clearly. You know, when you look through a glass, especially if that glass have water, but even if it doesn't have water, when you look through a glass, it's still going to distort the image on the other side so that you're not able to see it perfectly. Now, why is that? This is what I believe the reason why that is. I believe each one of us is one piece of the puzzle. And as being one piece, we are one part of the whole. See? So God gives us a little piece so that we are forced to come together as one. We are one body in Christ. So he gives us a little bit here and a little bit there and a little bit there and a little bit there and a little bit there. And by the time we all come together with our little piece, then we'll have the whole of it. We'll be able to see clearly. But for right now, we only see in part. The part that God gave us. You see? You understand? We only see in part. So let's let the Bible explain this to us a little bit better. So there you can see on this picture, there is Jesus. And Jesus has one body. But the body parts are scattered all around. As the pieces begin to come together, the body of Christ is made whole. So we are like the missing pieces of Christ's body. And when we come together, we will see in full. The body will be complete and we will be made whole. Therefore, we will all know in full and not in part because we have been grafted into the body of Christ. And there you can see the whole full picture. This is what we're going to look like in the spirit when we come together. It's not going to be missing pieces here, there, there, there. We're going to be one. We're going to be one with the Lord. And we will see the full. The Bible says, "For we know not what we shall be, but when we see him, we shall be what we see." We'll be just like Christ. Right now, we don't know the whole of it. But when we see him, we're going to be just like him. It said, "And we shall see him in full and be just like him." But right now, we don't know in full. So this is 1 Corinthians. And the 1 Corinthians teaches us about the body of Christ. And see, that's what I believe. That's why we only know in part, because we are certain parts of the body. But let's get into this and let's read it. It says, we are in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, if you want to get your Bibles. It says, now concerning spiritual gifts, brethren, I will not have you ignorant. You know that ye were Gentiles carried away unto these dumb idols, even as you were led. It says, wherefore I give you to understand that no man speaking by the Spirit of God calls Jesus a curse, and that no man can say that Jesus is Lord but by the Holy Ghost. Now, there are diversity of gifts, but the same Spirit. And there are differences of administrations, but the same Lord. So there's many gifts, one Spirit. Many diversities of offices, but one Lord. So they're starting to explain it. It says, and there are diversities of operations, but it is the same God which worketh in all. It says, but the manifestation of the Spirit is given to every man to profit withal. For one is given by the Spirit the word of wisdom. So God gives one of us wisdom. To another, the word of knowledge by the same Spirit. It says, to another, he gives faith. And by the same Spirit, another, the gifts of healing. And by the same Spirit, to another, the working of miracles. To another, prophecy. To another, discerning of spirits. To another, diverse kinds of tongues. To another, the interpretation of tongues. It says, but all these work it that one and the same self-spirit, dividing to every man severally as he will. So the Bible says to God had gave us all different gifts, different abilities, but it's all for the same purpose for the body. It's all for the same purpose. It's all for the same Spirit, just different gifts one to another. So as long as we stay apart, we will know in part. But when we begin to come together as the body of Christ, then we will know in full. So let's keep going to verse number 12. It says, for as the body is one and hath many members, and all the members of that one body being many are one body, so also is Christ. So he's saying Christ has just like the body that me and you have right now, our body has many members. It have 10 fingers, 10 toes, and on those fingers it has nails, and then it has knuckles, and then we have all of these parts. We have ears and two eyes and nose and two nostrils, and we have so many members in our body. And the Bible says just the same way our body has a lot of members, so also do the body of Christ has a lot of members. Okay, it says, now we're on verse 13. It says, for by one Spirit we're all baptized into one body, whether we be Jew or Gentile, whether we be slave or free. That's what bond means, slave or free, and have been all made to drink into one Spirit. For the body is not one member, but it is many. So it's going to take all of us coming together to make up the body of Christ. It says, if the foot shall say, because I am not the hand, I am not of the body, is it therefore not of the body? So the foot is saying, oh, well, I'm not the hand. The hand gets to do everything. I don't want to be a part of this body anymore because I'm not the hand. He said, does that still make the foot not a part of the body? Absolutely not. It's still a part of the body. You just got a different office. You just got a different gift. He said, number 16, if the ear shall say, because I am not the eye, I am not of the body, is it therefore not of the body? So the ear is like, man, all I get to do is just hear everything, but I'm not getting to see nothing. I don't feel like I'm a part of this. I don't feel like I want to be a part of this body. But he says, does that make it not so? No, that does not make it not so. It says it's still a part of the body. It just has its own function. It has its own thing. And we are on 17. If the whole body were an eye, where were the hearing? So if God said, if the body of Christ were just one giant eyeball, then how could the body of Christ hear? So we need the eye and we need the ear to make the body complete. It says, if the whole was hearing, where the smelling? So if the whole body of God was just the ear, then how can we smell? It says, we are on 18. It says, but now has God set the members, every one of them, in one body, as it hath pleased him. And if they were all one member, where was the body? So he said, if God just made one arm, then where's the rest of the body? It was needful to complete the body by having many different members. You know, if the brain says, oh, well, heart, you're useless because you're not the brain. All the consciousness is within me. If they're brain dead, then the body is no good. And then the heart was like, yeah, then maybe you have a point there. But you still need me, because without me, I pump the blood through the body, and life is in the blood. So you need me too. And then the lungs would be like, well, both of y'all think y'all better than me because you have the consciousness and you pump the blood. But without me, the body could not breathe. And so you will still die. And then and then the eyes chirp in and be like, oh, I see you guys have discredited me. But I'm equally important as you. Yeah, I might not pump the blood, and I might not hold the consciousness, and I may not make you breathe, but without me, y'all will be blind. You will be running into everything. And then so the feet was like, oh, I see, I'm not even added in a conversation. But you need me, because without me, you couldn't even walk anywhere. And the knees was like, well, don't discredit me. You absolutely need me, because without me, you cannot even bend to stoop or stand. So you definitely need me. And then the spine was like, whoa, okay, nobody's even adding me in the conversation, but you're definitely gonna need me, because without me, you could not sit upright. You could not, your body would be limp. You definitely need me to hold this all together. I'm definitely holding all of this together. So that's when the word begins to tell us, no one of us should think more highly of himself than he ought to, because we are all needed and we are all one. And when we come together, we will have the whole of it. But as long as we are single, we will only know in part. A heart is just a heart. As good as it's needed in the body, by itself, it's just a lone heart. And it doesn't even have any blood to pump. And even if the heart had blood, it's useless without the vessels. It still needs the blood vessels. So all of the members of the body, though there are many members, and though each member has its own function, we are being many members in the body. Some of us have prophecy. Some of us has the gift of sight. Some of us have the gift of knowledge. Some of us have the gift of healing. But we cannot discredit one to another. We are meant to come together as one. And I believe that's why God gives us in parts, because it was made so that we would have to come together to know the whole of it. All right, let's go to verse 18. That's where we're at. It says, but now hath God set the members, every one of them, in the body as it has pleased him. And if they were all one member, where were the body? But now are they many members, but yet one body. And the eye cannot say unto the hand, I have no need of you, nor again the head to the feet, I have no need of you. No, it says, much more those members of the body which seem to be more feeble, they are necessary. So God is saying, even the least amongst you, we cannot credit out none of us. Even the least amongst you, you're looking down at the homeless man, but guess what? He is a part of the body, and you need him, because even the least amongst you, he is the cornea of the eye. So though you have an eye, you still need the cornea. And though you have the cornea, you still need the pupil. And though you have the pupil, you still need the eyelashes. So the eye, though it may be seen to be small, it has many members in just one eye. You need everybody, so we can't afford to look down on one to another. All right, let's keep going. We're on number 23. It says, and those members of the body which we think to be less honorable, upon these we bestow more abundant honor. And our uncomely parts have more abundant comeliness. For our comely parts have no need. But God had tempered the body together, having given more abundant honor to that part which lacked, that there should be no schism in the body, but that the members should have the same care one for another. So God said, I made it thus, because if I didn't make it this way, then you guys will begin to think more highly of yourselves and you would not come together. I made the big parts so that they have to need the little parts. The body, you need the pancreas. It filters out all of the toxins. You need this. You need the kidneys. You need this. It's like you need the nerve endings because you need to be able to feel. Yes, it's not a major organ like the heart or anything like that, but you need it. You need the red blood cells. You need these things. So we need one another so that none can look down on one another. And as long as we continue to do that, we will continue to know in part. It says, let's start with number 27. It says, now you are the body of Christ and members in particular, and God has set some in the church, first apostles, secondly prophets, thirdly teachers, after that miracles, then gifts of healing, helps government, diversities of tongues. Are all apostles? No, they're not. Are all prophets? No, they're not. Are all teachers? Are all workers of miracles? Have all the gifts of healing? Do all speak with tongues? Do all interpret? But covet earnestly the best gifts, and yet show I unto you a more excellent way. God is saying there are different diversities of the body, and all of us each make up a different piece of the body. And that's why all of us have different talents. That's why all of us have different gifts in the spirit. Some of us can sing like hummingbirds. The ones that can't sing like hummingbirds, some of us can play instruments like a savant. We can master him. While me, I can't play Mary Had a Little Lamb, but God has given me the word. So I can't even play an instrument. I can't even draw. You've seen my drawings. But God has given me the ability to share the word in a way where people can understand it. So we all still need one another. And when we come together, we will have the whole of it. So this is what that scripture looks like in picture form or in the spirit realm. There is one body, there is one body of Christ, but in the body of Christ, there are many members, each having its own part. You and I collectively make up the one whole. Each of us is only one part of the one whole. Therefore, we need to come together as one. Well, you say, well, how do we do that? We are all scattered all over the earth. We are all so different. We all believe different things. How do we come together as one? Well, I'm glad you asked. We do that with love. It says, now you are the body of Christ, and each one of you is a part of it. 1 Corinthians chapter 12 and 27. I don't want you to ever forget that. You are important and you are needed. Let's keep going. Every one of us. See this? Isn't that beautiful? Together, we all make up the body of Christ. Christ is the head of the body. And we together are the members. And though the body has many members, yet it is still one. So as long as we stay separate, we only know in part because we have not all come together as one body. Look at this. It says the body of Christ. It says, we must remember that Christ is the head of the church, Ephesians 5:23, and that we are the members of his body, that we are meshed together for the purpose of accomplishing his goodwill. God's plan is for us to be a unified body. 1 Corinthians 12, verses 12 through 27. Each person, each member of the body has a special purpose given to them by God. Verse 18. In this way, there are not to be divisions within the group because all are working toward the same purpose and all are caring for one another. Verse 25. We are all capable of making valid contributions. So, when we begin to love one another, when we stop discriminating for one reason or another, because this person don't have money, they don't look right, they homeless, or I don't like the color of their skin, or she just look funny to me. Or when we just stop judging, oh, look at their car they driving, they driving a hoopty, or this or that, whatever reasons why people discriminate, or they like Trump, or they voted Biden, or they believe this, or they agnostic, or they don't, or they are this way and they are that way. It doesn't matter. And in the end, when we stop judging and we begin to come together as one, just like this, we will have the whole of the puzzle by just loving one another with no judgment. No judgment, coming together, working together as one to complete the body of Christ. This is, man, I hate when I do that. Okay, I'm sorry, I cut it off. I know we're in chapter 12 of something. We are in chapter 12 of something, but I cut it off. I'm sorry about that. I thought I had it in the picture, but let's read. It says, I beseech you, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, wholly acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. And be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove that which is good and acceptable and perfect will of God. For I say through the grace given unto me to every man that is among you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think soberly according as God has dealt to every man the measure of faith. For as we have many members in one body, and all members have not the same office, so we being many are one body in Christ, and every one member one of another. We are all connected, having the gift differing according to the grace that is given to us. Whether prophecy, let us prophesy according to the portion of faith, or ministry, let us wait on our ministry, or he that teacheth on teaching, or he that exhorteth on exhortation. He that giveth, let him do it with simplicity. He that ruleth with diligence. He that showeth mercy with carefulness. Let love be without dissimulation. Abhor that which is evil. Cleave to that which is good. Be kindly affectionate to one another. Be kind to one another. The Bible says, he that wanted friends must first show himself to be friendly. Be kind to one another. Be kindly affectionate to one another with brotherly love and honor, preferring one another, not slothful in business, fervent in spirit, serving the Lord, rejoicing in hope, patient in tribulation, continuing instant in prayer, distributing to the necessity of the saints, giving to hospitality. Be kind. Oh, you want something to drink? Do you want something to eat? Are you hungry? Be kind. Be hospitable to one another. Bless them which persecute you. Bless and not curse them. Rejoice with them that do rejoice. Weep with those that weep. Have compassion for one another. Be of the same mind one toward another. Mind not high things, but condescend to men of low estate. Be not wise in your own conceits. Recompense to no man evil for evil. That means repay to no man evil for evil. Provide things honest in the sight of all men. If it be possible, as much as lieth in you, live peaceably with all men. Dearly beloved, avenge not yourselves, but rather give place unto wrath. For it is written, vengeance is mine, I will repay, said the Lord. Don't go around trying to get even. Don't go around repaying evil for evil. God said, I got you. I'll handle that. Just keep loving your enemies. Do good one to another. He said, therefore, if your enemy hunger, feed him. If you're in a break room and you've been arguing with somebody and you see they hungry and you could tell they hungry, they looking at your food, offer to share with them. Even if you don't have no money to give them, you can just share the little that you have and God will repay you. If your enemy is hungry, feed him. If he thirsts, give him to drink. For in doing so, you shall heap coals of fire on his head. Then he's going to begin to feel bad. He's going to feel condemned. And that he's going to want to change his ways because God will begin to deal with his heart. He says, but be not overcome evil of evil, but overcome evil with good. So God wants us to love one another. That's how we're going to find all the missing pieces of the body. That's how we're going to know in full. Matthew chapter 22, verse 36 to 40. It says, Master, which is the greatest commandment in the law? Jesus said unto him, Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, and with all thy soul, and with all thy mind. This is the first and great commandment. And the second is like unto it. You shall love thy neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments hang all the laws and the prophets. God has said it is no greater commandment than to love God and to love your neighbor as you love yourself. Love, 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 love is the key. The Bible says love covers a multitude of sins. It's the key. Love is the key. We can do this, y'all. It says, though I speak with the tongues of men and of angels and have not charity, I am become as sounding brass or a tinkling cymbal. It says, and then you can read that down there. And we're going to pick up on verse 2. It says, and though I have the gift of prophecy and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and though I have all faith so that I could remove mountains and have not charity, which is love, I am nothing. And though I bestow all my goods to feed the poor, and though I give my body to be burned and have not love, it profited me nothing. Charity, which is love, suffereth long and is kind. Charity envieth not. Love does not envy. Charity valued. It vaunted not itself. It's not lifted up. It is not puffed up. We have to love, 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 love. That is the key. 1 Corinthians 13, verses 4 through 7. Love suffers long and is kind. Love does not envy. Love does not parade itself. It is not puffed up. It does not behave rudely. Does not seek its own. Love is not provoked. Love thinks no evil. Love does not rejoice in iniquity, but rejoice in truth. Love bears all things. Love believes all things. Love hopes all things. Love endures all things. Everything is love. And that's why Satan does not want us to love one another. But love is the key. Love is the key to finding, coming together, being whole, one whole body of Christ. Jeremiah 31, verses 2 through 4. It says, thus says the Lord, the people which were left of the sword found grace in the wilderness, even Israel, when I went to cause him to eat. The Lord had appeared of old unto me, saying, yea, I have loved thee with an everlasting love. Therefore, with loving kindness have I drawn you. God was like, I didn't draw you by condemning you. I didn't draw you by condemning you. You're not here because I kept condemning you every 24/7. You're here because I love you. You're here because when nobody was there for you at 2 a.m, when your heart was breaking, I was there for you. You're here because when you lost your job and people didn't think that you could get better, I gave you a job that you knew you wasn't qualified for. You're here because I have loved you and I have suffered long with you. He said, I didn't come into the world to condemn the world, but I came that the world might have life and have it more abundantly. No greater love than this, that a man lay down his life for a friend. You're not here because I condemn you. You're here because I loved you. Just as the saying goes, you can get more bees with honey than you can with vinegar. Love is the key. Love is the key. We need to love one another. That is the key. If you want to see, if you want to know and hold. 1 John 3:17. But whoso hath this world's good and seeth his brother have a need, and shutteth up his bowels of compassion from him, how dwelleth the love of God in him? So how are you saying you got the love of God in you if you have the money? Your bank account is nice. And you have the money and somebody asked you for $20 because their life's about to get turned off. And you was like, I ain't got it because they can't pay me back. How is the love of God in you? You see this man getting kicked out of 7-Eleven because he just wants to rummage through the trash. He just wants to get a little bit of money. He's just standing out there begging for money. What do you say he's going to get beer or alcohol? That's not your business. Let that be on God and him. Give him, if he say he's hungry, give him to eat something. If he say he's thirsty, buy him a drink. Even if 7-Eleven won't let him come in, you buy him a drink. Take it outside and give it to him. Love is the key. Love is the key. It says, James chapter 2, 14 through 16. What doeth it profit, my brethren, though a man say he have faith and have not works, can faith save him? If a brother or sister be naked and destitute of daily food, and one of you say unto them, depart in peace. You just pray for them, and you sent them on about their way. Be you warm and filled. Notwithstanding, you give them not those things which are needful to the body. What doeth it profit? So you are praying for somebody. They said, I need help. I'm homeless. I don't have no clothes. I don't know where my next meal going to come from. You said, oh, come on, let me pray for you. I know the Lord going to deliver. And you send them away. And the Bible says you don't give them nothing that they need for the body. Then what did that profit them? You have not helped them. And the Lord caused me to read the scripture one day. And then he tried me with it myself. I know that God means this. This even he taught us through the parable of the Good Samaritan. Right here. Let's get into that. The parable of the Good Samaritan is Luke chapter 10, verses 25 through 37. And we're going to start it at verse 30. Okay, we're going to verse 30. And Jesus answered and said, a certain man went down from Jerusalem to Jericho and fell among thieves. So the thieves robbed him, was stripped him of his clothes, remnant clothes, and wounded him, and departed, leaving him half dead. And by chance, just by chance, there came down a certain priest. He was a preacher that way. And when he saw him, he passed by on the other side. He even just crossed the street and like, you know what? I ain't getting involved in that. And he was a priest. And likewise, a Levite, when he was at the place, came and looked on him and passed on the other side. Don't quote me on this. I think it's a Levite. It's like a preacher in training or something like that. But don't quote me on that. It said, but a certain Samaritan, as he journeyed, came where he was. And when he saw him, he had compassion on him and went to him and bound up his wounds, pouring in oil and wine, and set him on his own beast. Like you put him in your own car, okay? That's the same equivalent. And brought him to an inn. And you saw this man. You went and got him a hotel room. And you took him to an inn and took care of him. And on the morning when he departed, he took out 2 pence and gave them to the host. So he pulled out his credit card and he paid the host. He paid up the room ahead of days. And he said to him, take care of him. And whatsoever you spend is more, when I come again, I will repay you. Whatever you spend more over than what I have given you, when I come back, I will repay you. He that has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit is saying. When you begin to do one for another and it's charging your pockets, God said, if it goes over a certain limit, when it come back, don't worry. I'm going to repay you. He says, which now of these three thinketh, do you think, was neighbor unto him that fell among the thieves? And he said, he that showed mercy on him, the one that showed him mercy, he was a neighbor. Then said Jesus unto him, go and do you likewise. Then you go do the same. You go be a neighbor one to another. Love thy neighbor as you love yourself. And in doing so, the body of Christ will come together as one. And we will no more know in part, but we will know in full, for we are one. All of us are many members, but yet one body. See? When you bring your part and connect yours to mine, and I connect mine to Sister So-and-so, and Brother Jim comes and he connects it, and just because this dude got tattoos and he looks a little scary, we can't discredit him. We need his peace too. And just because this person got locked up, we can't discredit him. We need that peace too. And just because this person was a prostitute, we can't discredit her. We need her peace too. You see what I'm saying? Just because she had kids at a young age, we can't discredit her. We need her peace too. Just because he was a dope dealer, we need his peace too. And he killed somebody, but guess what? We need his peace too. We cannot judge one to another. Let no man think of himself highly than he ought. And once we connect all of our pieces together with love and kindness, we will be able to see in full. It will be no more in parts, but it will be full, because we have all come together and completed the body of Christ. Hallelujah, Jesus. Oh my God. Hallelujah, Father God. I love you so much. Look at there. And this is the end of the video. I pray that this have blessed you in some type of way. To love, love is the greatest commandment. And we will know in part when we all come together as one. When all of our gifts and all of our body parts come together, we will definitely know in part. In Jesus' name I pray, be blessed. Amen.